But this week, it's all about Lesson Tuesday here today, and Dr. Kapil Gupta, who is with us here very shortly, will be watching his son compete in the drive, chip, and putt finals at Augusta National on Sunday. I caught up with Dr. Gupta earlier today. It's Lesson T Tuesday, and on the line, someone who's very wise approach to life and to life improvement, and by extension, golf game improvement, is really intriguing to me. Dr. Kapil Gupta, how are you today?
How are you, Sir Mark? Wonderful to be with you again.
Oh, it's my pleasure to have you. I'm always good, and I just want to get completely right into a quote that you made that has sort of caught my attention after you drew my attention to it, and it's really now, the more I consider it, the more it is really resonated with me, and I just want you, for our listeners, to embellish on this quote a little further, and I'll share it with you. The truth is this: unless a man comes to the game completely full, he will forever leave empty-handed. Off you go, then.
The game is a game. The game of golf is a ball-and-stick game. It is pure. It is sincere. It is simple. It is unadorned as it is. If you come to the game looking for something, if you come to the game looking to fill holes within yourself, if you come to the game looking to replenish what you believe to be your inadequacies, you will forever leave empty-handed, because you will forever feel disappointment far more than you will feel joy. And that is because the game has no inherent ability to give anything to anyone. It is just a field. It is just a scaffolding. It is just a structure and an arena which houses the play of those who come to it. It is not a wishing well. And to approach it thus is to really go away empty-handed.
Well, I'm interested then, now that you mention that, because obviously what you share is a complete truth. But now here's my question to you then. So let's say, for argument's sake, I'm a young guy, grew up in the game, started playing when I was a youngster, started to show a certain amount of proficiency, got competitive, success, blah, 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 all the rest of it. Now, all of a sudden, that success has continued to build. And again, I use the word success kind of loosely because I know where you're going to go with this probably. But now I start to develop as a golfer. What started as a childlike sort of an enjoyment and infatuation with the game now becomes competition. Talk a little further, connect the dots for me a little bit over there, because I start to ask questions now that you've made this truth to me. Now, how do I, if I've been venturing through the game and getting better, how do I sort of keep it and keep the game for what it is?
By understanding what, if anything, it's done to you in a negative fashion. If the game provides for you a source of joy, if the game allows you to be at peace and to maintain your level of freedom, there really is no conversation that needs to take place. The conversation only needs to take place, and it only arises if someone is suffering from the pangs of the game, mm-hmm. If someone finds himself lost within the game to the degree in which he can't find his way out of it. Only then do problems arise. And you mentioned a word, competition. We could go on and on about competition, but I will tell you, I'm sure it's shocking to you, but I take a very different stance on competition. You know, competition, I don't really agree with the concept.
Okay.
Outwardly, it is true. The same way it is always outwardly true to be in a certain way, that there are individuals in a golf tournament who are, quote, competing against one another. The problem with competition is it takes one away from the game.
Okay.
I would say that freedom, sincerity, and an allegiance to one's craft is in direct opposition and mutually exclusive of competition. Competition is sort of a look at the cards after the game has been played. But if competition is brought into the very bowels of the game cannot be played. It can only be competed. And as you compete, you lose yourself and you lose your equanimity.
That intrigues me, and it begs the question that, because you have a young man, his name slips my mind, do forgive me, but He is a very accomplished young golfer who has won the Drive Chip and Putt, has competed at Augusta National, which I guess is kind of timely because we're going there next week for the Masters tournament in 2015. How do you broach the subject with your young man for any parents that may be listening out there to Dr. Kapil Gupta?
A beautiful question and very poignant and very timely. We are going to Augusta National, where he will be playing on Sunday at the TCP at Augusta National. Now, I will tell you, it's been a very almost surreal experience because he's been put in the position where whenever we go to the golf course now, people come up to him and say, "You are going to win. You are going to win, aren't you? What are you going there to do?" In fact, one of the individuals today asked him, "So tell me, Abe," his name is Abe.
Abe, okay, right.
"Abe, are you going there to see the sights or are you going there to win?" And he said, "Neither. I am going there to have fun." And I do not discuss competition in my household. I do not discuss winning or losing. I don't believe in the concepts. There was a time in my life that I believed in nothing else, and I found that it produced such a detriment in my life that I would say that those concepts are almost unnatural to the way in which a human being is constructed. So I will say that when he goes to that tournament, we never talk about him competing anything. He is just playing. And wherever the dice may fall, they fall. He will bring his skills. He will bring the best of his masterpiece, and he will allow it to unfold on the grounds of Augusta National. And whatever the universe and whatever nature allows that to turn into at the end of the day is what it is, and it's beyond our control. And that's the way that we can become free and sincere, by looking at the game in that way.
And then, and forgive me for maybe this question may appear ignorant, but because he is very accomplished, and I've seen pictures of him with trophies and the like. Let's say, for argument's sake, he does go out there, he plays to the best, or he does to the best of his ability, enjoys the craft, he's succeeding at playing free, and happens to win the event. How do you keep that all in perspective for the young man that obviously could become very easy, I guess, to get wrapped up in the trappings of one's success?
And I think that all sort of goes, I think that where that goes depends upon what comments he continues to hear. You know, it is the substrate in which you are immersed, which tends to color the outcome. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, he has many trophies in his room, and both of my boys do. And he won all three of the qualifiers to get here. Mm-hmm. So there's been a lot of winning going on along the way, and yet we still don't discuss the winning. So, and the reason is because I believe it robs the human being of his freedom. If the winning happens by an organic fashion, then that's fine. But I will tell you, Mark, that the winning and losing is a very different game from golf. The winning and the losing is a very different game from hockey or soccer or baseball or basketball. That's its own game. And I would say it is a game that is very divorced from the fundamental and sincere game of golf. And when you sort of dip your toe into the winning and losing game, you must, by definition, leave the golf game.
Okay. Well, this stuff is really resonating with me. Now, I hate to use this word stuff. Pardon me. These principles are really resonating with me. And it starts to prompt my thinking a little further, because the more you speak, the more these are not just lessons for the golfers that are listening to this broadcast, it's also a lesson really to the parents who have talented kids that have shown a certain amount of proficiency to golf or to hockey, to football or basketball or whatever the case might be, right?
Yes, absolutely. And I will tell you that we are all human beings, Mark. We are all flawed human beings. And we go through life and try to find the best way in which to raise our children. And at the same time, we are also taking care of ourselves, because we haven't reached the state of ultimate realization ourselves. So we all have this need for our children to do well and hope that they succeed. And I think that's a real trap. And none of this is a prescription. I am not going to say that thou shall not expect your kids to succeed. Because those things, I don't believe in prescriptions. They don't work.
Yeah.
I will just say that if you come from a place of sincerity, do you enjoy it when you go to your kid's golf tournament and you live on the edge of your seat and you live and die with every chip and you live and die with every putt and you feel like you've been through a washing machine at the end of the day and you anticipate the next tournament and you hope you win and you're sad if you don't? Is that sort of cycle okay with you? Do you enjoy it? Do you believe that that's the way it has to be? Do you want to get out of it? And that's really where the organic part of the conversation comes from. To me, I find that to be literally a purgatory. I don't enjoy those feelings. Those feelings are ones that I want to be beyond and rid of and completely move past, because I feel the most joy when I don't care, when I could care less, when I allow him to go to the tournament and I'm on the sidelines, and I'm outside the velvet ropes, and the game takes place, and whatever happens, happens, and that way I can leave in the same way that I arrived. Freedom in, freedom out.
What an incredible place that is. You talk to me, and I hear you, and I feel you as a golf instructor who has been blessed to work with many golfers, major champions indeed. You know, to be able to be divorced from the results and just to embrace the craft and to allow it just to transpire and be as it will, that is a very free place to be, because you're absolutely right. If you are absolutely married to the results, you know, every shot almost becomes wrecked with a certain amount of anticipation and fear and trepidation. And it's like the golf shots just all of a sudden and take on an entirely different meaning, and a meaning more so than what they really are, where it's just a club interacting with a ball and a field, as you put it.
Absolutely. It is. They take on a massive significance. And you live and die by that significance. And as a result, you never really leave the field, Mark.
Mm-hmm.
You are always on the field. You are on it for your glory moments, and you are on it for your scars. And you live in that turmoil forever. And some will say, once again, it comes back to the individual and what he believes. Some will say, well, that's just the way it is. And I will never try to make him believe me, because a man convinced against his will is of the same opinion still, right? So I will simply say that I am captivated by the idea of standing in what is perceived to be the most critical aspect of the game and stand on the middle of the tee box in front of millions of people and smile.
What a wonderful lesson for coaches, for parents, for everyone listening to this broadcast. This very wise man on the other line is Dr. Kapil Gupta. I appreciate your time. I appreciate your insights as always. Where can our listeners find you, Dr. Gupta?
www.siddhaperformance.com. S like Steve, I like India, D like doll, H like Harry, and A like Apple, performance.com. My email and my phone number are there. And my Twitter handle is @siddhaperformance, and the FOR is actually a number 4.
Well, go out there and enjoy Augusta National. It's a blessed place. Have a great time with your son, and embrace it for what it is.